Throughout history, we as humans have tried to figure out what the world is. What is our world made of? Why do we do the things that we do? And although all of us ask ourselves these questions at some point in our lives, it is philosophers like Spinoza, Kant and Schopenhauer that made it their sole purpose in life to answer these questions. And following Kant, Schopenhauer provides a full description of what the world is in his masterpiece, The World as Will and Representation. Before writing this book, Schopenhauer first wrote his doctoral dissertation on the question, why? He did this in his book, On the Fourfold Root of the Principle of Sufficient Reason. This book forms the basis of his view on the world, and the basis of all other books that Schopenhauer has written. Therefore, we recommend watching our video on that book before watching this video. Now, the book The World as Will and Representation is made up out of four parts. The first describing the world as representation, the second describing the world as will, and the third and fourth describing the general implications of these descriptions. In this video, we will look at the first two books and discover the basics of our existence, the kernel of our being. It is almost absurd how these books are able to give us both a sense of despair and of redemption at the same time. It is therefore no wonder that this work forms the foundation of some of the most prominent thinkers that succeeded Schopenhauer. Philosophers like Nietzsche, but also psychoanalysts like Freud, Lacan and Jung. Now, without fangirling too much, let me show you what I mean by presenting Schopenhauer's The World as Will and Representation. The world is my idea. This is truth which holds good for everything that lives and knows, though only man can bring it into reflected, abstract consciousness. If he really does this, philosophical discretion has evolved in him. It then becomes clear to him, and certain, that he knows not the sun, and not an earth, but only an eye that sees the sun, and a hand that feels the earth. That the world which surrounds him exists only as idea. That is, only in relation to something else. The one who conceives the idea, which is himself. This is how Schopenhauer opens his first book, and it already claims that the world as we experience it can only be our idea. But what does this mean? On the one hand, there is the real world, the world of objects, with all its forces, phenomenon and mystique. On the other side is the subject, that is us. And now the thing is that we can only ever perceive the world with our senses. We only see the projection of what the world actually is. We do not see gravity. We only see the apple fall, which is the representation of gravity. Furthermore, whenever we see, hear or feel, this is merely data that is interpreted by our brains, and thus that which is perceived only exists in our minds. All of these phenomena and ideas are conditioned by the principle of sufficient reason, that is, by space, time and causality. The apple only falls in time and space, which is our idea of the world. And it is because we can only ever see the representation of the world in time, space and causality that we start to make the distinction between us and them, or what Schopenhauer calls the principium individuationis. For only through the medium of time and space does that which is one and the same, both by its nature and by its concept, appear as different, as a plurality of coexistent and successive phenomena. Time and space are in consequence the principium individuationis. In other words, we only exist in relation to something else. And thus, what the principium individuationis implies is that without the subject, that is, without space, time and causality, there is no world, since this only existed in relation to the principle of sufficient reason. This idea is illustrated by Schopenhauer, where he presents a dialogue between a subject and matter. I am, and besides me there is nothing, for the world is my idea. What a crazy presumption! I am, and besides me there is nothing else, for the world is my fleeting form. You are merely the sum of a part of this form, and entirely accidental. What foolish arrogance! Neither you nor your form would be there without me. You are conditioned by me. Anyone who thinks me out of existence and then believes he can still think you there is in the grips of a gross delusion. For your existence, apart from my idea, is a direct contradiction, a nonsense. You are simply means that you are perceived by me. My idea is the place where you exist. Hence, I am the first condition of your existence. Fortunately, your impudent assertion will soon be refuted in a real way, and not by mere words. In a few more moments, you will actually no longer be. With all your boasting, you will have leapt into the void, will have drifted past like a ghost, and suffered the fate of all of my transient forms. But I will remain, unscathed and undiminished. From millennium to millennium, through infinite time, and without qualms, I will observe the play of my changing forms. This infinite time, through which you proudly claim to live, exists, like the infinite space you fill, only in my idea. Indeed, it is merely the form of my idea. The form I carry, ready made up, within me, and in which you show yourself. Which receives you, and by means of which you exist in the first place. But the annihilation with which you threaten me does not affect me. For if it did, then you would be annihilated along with me. Rather, it merely affects the individual, which temporarily supports me, and is, like everything else, my idea. And if I concede this, and go as far as to regard existence as something which has an independent life, it will still remain dependent upon mine. For you are a subject only insofar as you have an object, and I am this object. I am its kernel and its content, the permanent part of it, the bonds that bind it together, and without which it would be as incoherent, tenuous and insubstantial as the dream and fantasies of your individuals. So then, we are inseparably joined together, as parts of one whole which comprises both of us, and exists by virtue of us. Only a misunderstanding can set us against each other, and mislead one into disputing the other's existence, along with which his own existence stands or falls. This totality that encompasses the two is the world as idea, or the phenomenon. Once this is taken away, there will remain only the purely metaphysical, the thing in itself, which in the second book we shall recognize as the will. As a starting point for the will, Schopenhauer uses Kant's principles of transcendental idealism. Here, Kant divides the world into two categories. The world of representation, which is where the relation lies between the subject and the object that is structured by the principle of sufficient reason as seen in the previous section, and the world as things in themselves. This observation of Kant is, according to Schopenhauer, one of Kant's greatest achievements. According to Kant, there should be something that structures our representation of the world, our idea, that exists independent of us. And according to Kant, these would be transcendental objects. However, according to Schopenhauer, there is a fundamental error in Kant's definition of things in themselves. For, according to Kant, things in themselves are the objects which cause our representation. But this makes no sense, since for causality to occur, we need a knowing subject within the principle of sufficient reason, which belongs to the idea. Furthermore, objects only exist in space and time. And thus, to say that the thing in itself is an object would be absurd. However, the things in themselves do exist according to Schopenhauer, but just in a different form than described by Kant. For there is something outside of the principle of sufficient reason, that is, outside space, time and causality, which is the kernel of all processes that exist in this world. And this is what Schopenhauer called the will. The will of which we are speaking, he will recognize as the inmost nature, not only of those phenomena which are closely similar to his own, in men and animals, but further reflection will lead him also to recognize the forge by which the crystal is formed, that by which the magnet turns to the North Pole, the force whose shock he experiences from the contact between different metals, the force which appears in the elective affinities of matter as repulsion and attraction, separation and combination, and lastly, even gravitation, which pulls so powerful through all matter, draws the stone to the earth and the earth to the sun. All these he will recognize as different only in their phenomenal existence, their idea, but in their inner nature as identical, as what is directly known to him so intimately and so much better than anything else, and which, in his most distinct manifestation, is called will. Only this use of reflection forbids us to stop at the phenomenon, and instead beyond it, to the thing in itself. All idea, of whatever kind it may be, all object, is phenomenon. But the will alone is thing in itself. The most universal form of the will is the lower objectification of the will, which can be seen in forces like gravity, chemical reactions, thermodynamic processes, and so on. It is, however, important to note here that the will itself is not by any means bound by the principle of sufficient reason, that is, by causality. These forces, like gravity, can never be called either cause or effect in and of themselves. They do, of course, undeniably manifest themselves in accordance with the law of cause and effect, so that their each and every separate manifestation has a cause which is itself, in turn, a similar separate manifestation which determines that this force must express itself here, must here emerge into space and time. And yet the force itself is by no means the effect of a cause, nor is it the cause of an effect. Hence, to say gravity is causing the stone to fall is also incorrect. For the cause here is, rather, proximity to the earth, in that it is attracting the stone. Move the earth away and the stone will not fall, although gravity is still where it had been. Now, following the lower objectification of the will, there is also the higher objectification of the will, that is, the overcoming of the lower objectification. For example, to overcome gravity, humans have developed muscles to constantly battle the forces which resist movement. Or in other words, we have motivation. We can see here the relation, for example, to the theory of libido by Freud. For it is the objectification of the will, the drives, that guide our desires and thus our actions. So, the part of the body must perfectly correspond to the principal desires through which the will manifests itself. They must be the visible expression of these desires. Teeth, throat, and intestines are objectified hunger. The genitals are objectified sexual desire. The grasping hands, the swift feet, correspond to the striving of the will, which they represent at a grade lower and more indirect. Not only humans, however, but in all life, we can see this higher objectification of the will. And whether the objectification of the will is shown in a tree that creates fruits, which in time become a new tree over and over again, or the genitals of humans which create offspring, they all show a particular form of the will. That is, the will to live. And without this will to live, there would be no world, no object, and no subject. Will is the thing in itself, the inner content, the essence of the world. Life, the visible world, the phenomenon, is only the mirror of the will. Therefore, life accompanies the will as inseparably as the shadow accompanies the body. And if will exists, so will life, the world, exist. Life is, therefore, assured to the will to live. And so long as we are filled with the will to live, we need have no fear of our existence, even in the presence of death. It is true, we see the individual come into being and pass away. But the individual is only phenomenal, exists only for the knowledge which is bound to the principle of sufficient reason, to the principium individuationis. Certainly, for this kind of knowledge, the individual receives life as a gift, rises out of nothing, then suffers the loss of this gift through death, and returns again to nothing. Birth and death belong merely to the phenomenon of will, thus to life. and it is essential to this to exhibit itself in individuals which come into being and pass away, as fleeting phenomena, appearing in the form of time, phenomena of that which in itself knows no time, but exhibits itself precisely in the way as we have said, in order to objectify its peculiar nature. In an ironic way, it is also in the will to live that we can see what the Christian meant with the claim that life is suffering. For the constant will to live implies need and necessity. It implies desire. And in order to live, we are constantly battling the forces of nature. That is why withering plants are almost a universal symbol for suffering. For the plant signifies the need for water. And we too know this necessity to sustain our own life. We too need water, food, sleep, and so on. But as we have seen in history, and even in this day and age, these basic needs are often not fulfilled. Hence, in this way, every manifestation of the will, including that which expresses itself in the human organism, wages a constant war against the many physical and chemical forces which, as lower ideas, have a prior right to that matter. Hence the comfortable sensation of health, which proclaims the victory won by the idea of the self-conscious organism over the physical and chemical laws which originally governed the humors of the body. But this comfortable sensation is so often interrupted by, and is always accompanied by, major and minor discomfort arising from the resistance of those factors. In this way, the vegetative part of our life is constantly associated with mild suffering. Hence, the burden of physical life in general, the inevitability of sleep, and finally, of death. And this brings us to the end of this video. I will leave you with a short summary of what we have seen in this video. The world presents itself to us as the idea that is conditioned by the principle of sufficient reason, that is, by space, time, and causality, or, as the Hindus say, by the veil of Maya. To him is shown, instead of the thing in itself, only the phenomenon in time and space, in the principium individuationis, and in the other forms of the principle of sufficient reason. It is this veil of Maya that divides a representation of the world into us and them, when in reality a continuum faces us. We see our body, for example, as something different from the world around us, while in reality our beating heart is nothing different from the flowing water in the rivers. What lies underneath a representation of this world, however, is the thing in itself, the will, in all its objectifications. And the highest objectification of the will is the will to live. Since every goal attained is the new starting point of a new lap in the race, and so on ad infinitum. From the seed by way of the stem and the leaf, the plant advances its phenomenal existence to the point of blossom and fruit, which is again only the beginning of a new seed, a new individual that runs through the old cycle, and so on to time without end. The course of an animal's life is similar. Its peak is procreation, and once it has reached this peak, the life of the first individual will sooner or later wane, while a new life guarantees the preservation of the species in nature and repeats the same phenomenon. But it is precisely in this will to live that we find the reason for our suffering, the constant battle to overcome the will in all its lower objectifications. This is our world as will and representation. Thank you for watching this video. I hope that you found it interesting. If you did, or if you have any questions, please let us know in the comments below. For now, my will commands me to say goodbye. I hope that something good happens to you today, or tomorrow, and to see you in the next video.